Oh man, what makes me happy? I don't know, a lot of stuff makes me happy.
Doing something that I really like care about.
Probably the biggest thing is relationship.
Like awesome people make me more happy.
Happiness is a feeling that comes from inside.
Doing something good in the world and seeing a tangible change as a result of it.
Food.
Mostly helping other people.
Laughing, reading.
Spending time in nature or like plants.
I'm sure there is more to life. I think if you can achieve great happiness in your life, then you've done pretty well.
More to life than what I'm doing right now?
Huh. That's a tough one.
I would hope that there is something more than this.
I don't, honestly. But I'm not upset about it, really.
I feel like there is some kind of purpose. I haven't really figured it out.
I think that we're more or less just chemicals.
There's a lot of secrets to life.
The only certainty is there's more, but so I'm agnostic as to what.
I mean, the body is just a physical aspect, a physical manifestation of a spiritual experience.
I don't know if there's anything after this. I don't know.
There has to be something bigger than my life.
Yeah, I think there's more than this life. I think humans have something built into them that wants more, and I don't think that would be there if it was only this.
Is there more to life than this? It's a great question. It's a question we recently just put out in banners in our front yard. If any of you drove by, you saw the big Alpha banners, and the main question is there more to life than this? It's a question worth wrestling with. If the camera had gotten turned on you in those street interviews, and someone asked you, is there some greater purpose to running around and killing yourself to get it all done? What is it? I think if we're being honest, we're left with more questions in the world than answers. It doesn't matter whether you grew up and knew God and went to church your whole life, or you're like some of your friends, and you're going, I don't know why those people get up on Sunday morning extra early. You know you can just go to Bob Evans right from bed, right? We're all left with questions. And I think that having questions, being willing to wrestle with questions is crucial. In fact, this next season at Shiloh, that's what it's going to be all about. It's all about wrestling with questions. Because if we're going to be the people that can tell God's stories, that can tell Shiloh's stories, that can tell our stories, we've got to be people that are willing to wrestle with questions. That's the reason we're starting our fall semester off with Alpha. It's an international study where people come together, and it's supposed to be an open time for people, no matter where you fall on the faith journey, to chat about who this God thing and what this is all about. So if you've got friends that this God thing isn't their thing, but they at least would like to talk about it, Alpha is the place for you. If you're the person that has a lot of friends and you wish you had some answers, Alpha is the place for you. If you have faith questions, even though you've grown up at church or new to church and you just want to know more about God, Alpha is the place for you. Join us on Wednesday nights. But that's not the only thing we're doing around questions. We're getting ready to start this series called God Is. Fill in the blank. It's actually fun. When we posted this on Facebook, we had this image. It said, God is, and we didn't expect it, but some people just sent in words to fill in the blank for us. It was pretty cool. It was interesting, some of the responses, but it was pretty cool. The God Is series, it's based around what our pastoral staff, Pastor Daniel, Pastor Dave, and myself, believe are the three truths about God that change everything. When nothing else made sense, when you're struggling to figure out what the purpose of all this, we want to, over the next 3 weeks, offer you three absolute truths that we find straight out of Scripture, ones that you can always count on. We expect these truths to truly change how you experience life. So as we get started with that, let's jump into the series. I know we've got a brand new bulletin, and so some of you may not know how to follow along on the message map. If you open up, it should be the very first page on the inside is our message map. You can follow along on there. Will you pray with me? Almighty Lord, we come with questions. We come knowing there's more to know about you than what we do know about you. We come with skepticism. We come with open heart. We come because we realize God is a lot of things to a lot of people. And we want it to be a lot of things to us. So Lord, as we enter into this new series, help reveal absolute truths about who you are and what that means for our everyday life. Lord, we love you and we gather in your name this morning. And all God's people said, amen. The absolute truth that we're going to wrestle with this morning is straight out of the New Testament and Old Testament. It's said multiple places, but I think it is said best by King David in Psalm 99, which Amy read for us. There's this refrain in the psalm, and this is what it says. It says, let them praise your great and awesome name. He is holy. Exalt the Lord our God and worship at his footstool. He is holy. Exalt the Lord our God and worship at his holy mountain. For the Lord our God is holy. God is holy. Now, for many of us, as we gather in this room and in a place where we gather for worship, that sounds wonderful and maybe even a bit obvious. God is holy. For others, whether they're in this room or they're watching online, you can understand that you need to recognize that for some people, just the statement God is, don't worry about the adjective you're going to put on the end, just the statement God is worth wrestling with by itself. But today we're going to focus on God is holy. And so if we believe God is holy, because in the New Testament, the Old Testament, it keeps repeatedly saying that, in order to understand God deeper, we need to understand the adjective that describes God, which is holy. So let's dig into what holy means in a little bit of a deeper way. By the way, if you're the one wrestling with God is, come to Alpha. It'll be worth your time. We'd love to have a chat with you. God is holy. How do we swallow that statement when reality, when life happens? When things seem like they're just absolutely upside down, how can we say God is holy? When we get in a car accident, God's holy? When the divorce papers get delivered to us at work, God is holy? When we get called into the boss's office at work and we find out that we are now out of work, God is holy? When our friends or family are struck with cancer, God is holy? When life starts happening, see, we do this reality check, and all of a sudden things that we assumed or we thought were obvious before now get called into question. When we're here worshiping, God is holy, amen, let's raise our hands and praise the Lord. But when life happens, God is holy? It becomes something we want to wrestle with. I always remember the phone call that interrupted everything at my time at Ohio University when I was there for my undergrad. My roommate received the call that he'd been dreading. See, he had a best friend back at home who had been fighting cancer. And the phone call said, it's time to come home because your best friend has about 24 to 48 hours to live. We jumped in the car, we raced home, and he sat bedside and watched a 17-year-old best friend die of cancer. Where's God in that? sayings like God is holy doesn't seem like it necessarily has the same boost as it does when we're saying it in worship. The statement God is holy isn't so natural anymore. But what do we do with it? Because we find it in the New Testament, the Old Testament, repeatedly. God is holy. Now for me, the statement God is, that's not a wrestling spot for me. You know, the I am is the great I am. I understand that. God is unquestionably real to me. And in my opinion, I know God is real because the way the simplest cell works, the way when I cut my thumb, it heals on its own. When I stand at the top of the mountains and I see the vastness of the creation, when I stop at the edge of the ocean, I'm in awe. None of that stuff could have happened on accident. So God is true for me. But in the wake of cancer, God is holy. That one's a little bit harder for me to accept. God is holy. So let's get into that holy word. Let's get a little deeper and try to understand what it means. I think we have this pretty common understanding. We don't even need to look it up in Webster or even the Bible, that holy is sacred. And sacred is just this time and place where we experience God more often. For some of us, it may be music or prayer or walking in the woods. Or if you're like me, when your toes just barely dip into the ocean and that's all you can see and you're standing on the beach, that's a divine encounter. For some, this building is a building that's sacred. And you know how I know that? Is because I've hung out with some of you outside the building, and there's certain words or phrases you don't mind using outside the building. But somehow when we're in the building, we don't say those. Because this, for a lot of us, is sacred space, holy space. And this concept of holy and sacred, it comes right out of, it comes a number of places, but where I found it was in Joshua 4. We find Joshua leading the Israelites. He's just been handed the nation of Israel over from Moses, and he says, hey, I got them here. All you got to do is take them the rest of the way. And Joshua has his very first leadership opportunity, but also leadership problem, obstacle that he has to face. He comes up against the Jordan River. How do I get an entire nation of people across the river safely? This is kind of the first thing I've ever done. I don't want to be the guy that drowned half the nation. So he prays, and God says, listen, I did it to the Red Sea, and I'll do it here. I'll split it open, and you can walk across on dry land. But before you go, I want to give you these directions. We read in Joshua 4, 2, 3, choose 12 men from among the people, one from each tribe, and tell them to take up 12 stones from the middle of the Jordan, from right where the priests are standing, and carry them over with you and put them down the place where you stay tonight. One of the things I love about this story is most of the time when God gives these kinds of things, then we find out what happened wrong in the story, but that's not what happened here. People literally just do what God says. They just cross on the dry land. It's amazing. And then they get to camp that night. So we jump ahead in verse 20 to 24, and Joshua set up at Gilgal the 12 stones they had taken out of the Jordan. He said to the Israelites, in the future, when your descendants ask their parents, what do these stones mean? Tell them Israel crossed the Jordan on dry ground. For the Lord your God dried up the Jordan before you until you had crossed over. The Lord your God did to the Jordan what he had done to the Red Sea when he dried it up before us until we had crossed over. He did this so that all the people of the earth might know that the hand of the Lord is powerful, and so that you might always fear the Lord your God. Joshua and God create sacred and holy space around 12 stones that are supposed to be at the bottom of the river. Why? So when the grandkids, the children of the descendants, when the grandkids say, what's up with that tower of stones? They can say, our God is powerful. God is holy. Holy is sacred. Our God is a God that wants to create sacred space. And so what that means for me is our God is a God that wants to invite us in and wants to invite us in relationship, a God that pursues us. And that sounds great until reality gets called into play. Sitting bedside watching a 17-year-old get their body destroyed by the chemicals we try to kill cancer with, and then he ultimately dies anyways. Having a God that calls me. I mean, that's great, but that's not enough. I need something more. So I keep reading in Scripture, and I keep trying to find out, what does God is holy mean? Why is it so important? Why do we keep saying it over and over? How is this an absolute truth? And then I find this understanding of holy is other. Holy is other. See, God is not a finite human. God doesn't have an expiration date. God is holy and he is other. In the New Testament, Peter writes, but just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, be holy because I am holy. Peter is writing people and he says, you got to understand that God is holy and we are supposed to try to chase him down by being pure and perfect because that's what God is. And you know where Peter got that? He didn't come up with it on his own. He actually was referencing Leviticus, which is a book of laws out of the Old Testament that had all the rules about how to be pure and perfect. In Leviticus chapter 11, verse 44, it says, I am the Lord your God. Consecrate yourself and be holy because I am holy. Do not make yourself unclean by the creature that moves along the ground. These scriptures name God as something other than us, and therefore something we ought to be pursuing. God is other than us. And that's helping me when life's starting to happen, reality's starting, okay, God's bigger than me, God's different than me. That's about all it says to me. It's okay, God is other. God is other. But I'm not satisfied. Someone once challenged me, and I think they're absolutely right. They said, would a God that you could fully understand be worth following? The answer is no. Because if I could fully understand God, then guess what? I get to be God. But when life's happening, reality's getting checked, when I'm digging into what's happening around the world, having a God that's sacred and holy, having a God that's holy and other, I mean, those are great and those are important, but I need something more. And then I found it. It was in a third understanding of holy. And it was from a book that really doesn't even talk about holiness. It was from the book of Daniel. We read about a powerful king named Nebuchadnezzar. And every time he went in to take over a town, he would take the best and the brightest and he would move them into his own palace and he would feed them and he would teach them and these would be the most powerful and best people in his kingdom. And so he goes to Jerusalem, he captures people and he takes the best and the brightest back to his palace and one of those is Daniel. And when Daniel's offered the great food of the palace and all these teachings, this is Daniel's response. But Daniel resolved not to defile himself with the royal food and wine. And he asked the chief official for permission not to defile himself this way. See, Daniel decided to do what is good. He knew that his practices that he grew up, that was good because it was holy. And so Daniel said, even in these circumstances, I want to do what's good and what's holy. So good and holy. Holy is good. But I got bad news. You guys already knew that. You know how I know you already knew that? Play along with me. God is good. All the time. Yeah, we got all the way to here in the sermon, and now I'm telling you stuff you already know. God is good. Now you may be thinking, really? God is good. And in all these life circumstances, God is good is enough for you, Brent? When you said all these other things, those weren't enough, but this is enough? Yes. Walk with me. Let me tell you why. If you're a math person or if you're a computer programmer or if you take any logic classes, you study these if-then statements. If this is true, then this must be true. If I eat chocolate cake, then I gain weight, right? If I exercise, then I lose weight. You can even mess with it. If I eat chocolate cake, then I should exercise. Or if I exercise, then I deserve chocolate cake. So, right, we have these if-then statements. But Daniel's if-then statement is different than the ones I hear us making so far. Daniel's if-then statement, if we want to say, you know, if my friend died of cancer, then God is not here, not present, not real. If we're going to take that same formula to Daniel's story, it would sound like this. If I was captured and taken away from home, then God doesn't matter, and what the king says must be true. But that wasn't Daniel's story, was it? He didn't say, if I was captured, then I'll just do what the king is, because he obviously is the one that protects me. No, see, we constantly are in this, if I'm in a car accident, then God must not care about my safety, must be true. If I got the divorce letter, then that means God must not care about my marriage. If I got, the boss called me and I lost my job, then God must not care about my family's well-being. If somebody in my family died of cancer, it must be because God is absent, not real, fake, not a healer, like they say. Because that's the if-then statement we've been working with. But Daniel works with a very different if-then statement. He flips what they call as the constant and the variable. So the constant comes right after if. If this is true, that's the constant. Then the variable must be true. We've been saying, if my perception, if my view, if my thing is true, then this must be true of God. Daniel's story flips those backwards. He says, if God is holy, is true, then me being captured and taken from home must mean that I am still striving to be holy. See what happens? Daniel doesn't say, it's my perception, it's how I see the world that defines God. No, he says, God is God. He's the God of yesterday, he's the God of today, and he's the God of tomorrow, no matter what my life circumstances are. My life circumstances do not define who God is. The constant is God, and I am the variable. When my life circumstance falls apart, that doesn't change who God is. When my friend dies of cancer, that doesn't change who God is. When I get in a car accident, that doesn't change who God is. The constant is God, the variable is me. And so if God is holy, then X must be true, but God is still holy. So church, a lot of times we want to make God in our own image. If God is Republican, then, oh, wait, or Democrat, I don't really care which way you go. If God sees things how I see, then, because we want a God that represents us instead of us representing God. So the absolute truth I find in God is holy is that there are constants and there are variables. And we want to define God in our circumstance and our variable, but the reality is God is God. God is sacred. God is other. God is holy. And that's the constant, no matter what variable your life may bring you. So, church, do we want to be the church or the people that are willing to limit who God is by our own view and perception? Or do we want to be the people that has an almighty Lord that defines who we are and what our circumstances are and how we must act? If God is holy and I'm in a car accident, God's still holy. If God is holy and I get the divorce papers, God is still holy. God is holy, and I lose my job, God is still holy. If God is holy, and that 17-year-old man dies in that hospital bed. God's still holy. Will you pray with me? Almighty Lord, help us understand our perception, our circumstances. And you care about them and you love them and they're important to you, but they don't define who you are. Because God, you are holy. So no matter what we face, no matter how many questions we think we may have, let us find the confidence in knowing that you are holy. No matter what variable may happen in our life, you are the constant. And so, Lord, we're going to stand and worship one more song because you are a holy God. We love you, Lord. And all God's people said, amen. Amen.